good morning to everybody. And it's great to have here today Deirdre McCloskey, who is a professor of economics, history, English, and communication at the University of Illinois at Chicago. She's also visiting a professor at Göteborg, and briefly, let me say, also visiting here in the Foscari University. So when you introduce such an high personality, you usually say that she did too many things and she wrote too many things to summarize everything. Usually this is not really true, you can really summarize it, but in this case it's almost impossible, also because she wrote on topics about which a person I don't know anything, like philosophy, rhetorics, and many other fields. So we'll say something about at least the economic part of her career. So she was trained in Harvard, and as an economist, she's written something like 15 books and something like 400 articles on topics such as economic theory, economic history, philosophy, rhetoric, feminism, ethics, and law. And she taught for 12 years in the Department of Economics of the University of Chicago, when the University of Chicago was the University of Chicago. And she describes herself now as a postmodern, free market, quantitative, episcopalian, feminist aristocrat. I can understand only the free market quantitative part. She's currently writing a book, which is the second of a series of four books. The first was The Bourgeois Virtues on Dutch and British Economic and Social History between 1600 and 1800. The second book is Bourgeois Towns, How Capitalism Became Ethical, and before her best-known books were The Rhetoric of Economics and Crossing a Memoir, which was a New York Times notable book. In the field of economic history, Deirdre has written seminar articles on open field agriculture in medieval ages, on trade and growth in the 19th century, on gold standard and on the Industrial Revolution. Here I'd like to remember at least two articles that I like very much, the wonderful papers that are at the origins of, in a sense, of what we call nowadays theometrics, if you allow me, or at least of what we call the Chicago approach to economic history, the empirical approach. One is a Journal of Economic History paper on 1972 on the enclosure of open fields, and the other is an American Economic Review paper of 1984 written with John Nash, on corn at interest, the extent and cost of grain storage in medieval England. But today, Deirdre will speak about the empirical approach to economics, her famous critique to the use of statistical significance in economics. So all the empirical economists who are here at the end of the talk will feel a little guilty for using statistical significance in an inappropriate way. I will feel twice as guilty because I also wrote an economic history looking for economic significance of some coefficients. And with this, I leave the floor to Deirdre.
Thank you. Very much. Can we call the question after a while? Actually, in that series of books called The Bourgeois Era, I'm further along. I now have two books. One's called The Bourgeois Virtues. The second one that came out in 2010 called Bourgeois Dignity. Why economics cannot explain the modern world. And it's kind of against, well, lots of things. And volume three is in preparation. It's called The Treasured Bourgeoisie. How innovation became ethical, 1600 to 1848. And in that research, just as a place to start, I'm as quantitative as I can be, particularly in volume two, the one published in 2010, is a very quantitative book. I mean, there aren't very many tables, but it's always about quanto. That's the question. How big is the effect of imperialism on the prosperity of Europe? How big could the effect of foreign trade be? How big is, I don't know, the force of a kind of a solo type growth theory model. How big, how big, how big? Quanta, quanta, quanta. And it's yet in that great big book, it's 500 pages. I urge you to buy it. It's a wonderful book. It's available on Amazon.com. Cheap. I don't use statistical significance once. Now, understand, regression analysis, multiple regression, is fine, is wonderful. Why not? It's a way of summarizing multi-dimensional data. By the way, we should stop calling it data, which in Latin means things given, and start calling it capta, from amcapio, if you remember your high school Latin. Things seized, things taken, right? Things taken. Anyway, summarizing a hyperplane, or fitting a hyperplane, hey, who would object to such a thing? To have any objection to that would be like objecting to finding an average. Make no sense. Although, you know, some of my colleagues in the English department, they don't want to hear about numbers. They accept page numbers and line numbers. But they don't want to hear quantitative. Oh, no, quantitative, it's inhuman. No, no, it's, I don't want to hear, oh, yucca. And I'm not that way. As you mentioned, I'm a quantitative person. Many, many scientific questions, in fact, almost all of them, are not all, no, perhaps not all of them, but an awful lot of them are matters of how much, quanto. You know, you want to know if, I don't know, you ought to impose a tax on hotels in Venice, more taxes on hotels in Venice. As economists, we know that the sensible way to do that, if you're employed by the Comune di Venezia, or Comune Venezia, however you say it, you want to know the elasticity of demand. If you drive away the tourists, then you get enough, then you lose money if you raise the taxes. So how much is central to our discipline? How big is the wealth effect in macroeconomics? We've just been through a period where we discovered, whoops, it's kind of big. How much is our say, windfalls, as we say in English, that is, suddenly acquired income, how much is that viewed as permanent income or transitory? You know, makes a big, big difference for macroeconomics. Et cetera. It's quantity, quantity, quantity. So I'm not against quantities, not by any means. I'm not against curve fitting. At all. The problem comes in testing. That's the problem. And it's helpful to know that the procedures we use come from a man named, in the 1920s, named Ronald Almer Fisher, who was a great scientist. He's famous in genetics, for example. So he was, and he's famous in statistics. We call it the F test in honor, of course, it was Fisher who conferred the honor on himself, but let's like put that aside. He gives you some insight into this guy's personality, but an F-test is a test of the significance of a multiple regression. It's a generalized t-test.
Yeah.
Okay. And he's the one who set to take the most simple, uncontroversial part of the case I'm going to make this afternoon. The simplest way to put this, not the complete way, but the simplest, the one that even if you've had many courses in econometrics, you will understand. Those of you who have not had very many courses in econometrics will understand me this afternoon much better than those who have had many courses. But even if you've had many courses in econometrics, you understand that two standard deviations, a 5% level of significance, is arbitrary. Two. Perché due? I mean, what's going on here? Why two? Well, you know, seems reasonable, 5%. I don't know. So it's arbitrary. And that, it's worth thinking about that for a while. Because we all know in our own lives, you know, suppose riding the Vaporetti in Venice, you had a 5% of being crushed by the boat every time you got onto it. And Ronald Fisher would say, stop worrying. It's 5%. What do you want? You want certitude? Don't you know that chance is the ever-present alternative? Don't worry. Well, what's obviously crazy about that, Pozzo, is that it is that the loss function is very asymmetric. Or to put it, you know, I don't want two standard deviations chance of being crushed by the Vaporetto crashing against me. I mean, that's right, the boat crashing against me. I want 0.000, you know, I want a really low, I want many standard deviations, right? So we all, and for the gain, you know, gain, loss, for the gain of a quicker trip to San Marco than I could walk, I'm not willing to take on a risk of 5% of being crushed in my legs or killed, right? So even if you've had many courses in econometrics, even if you are an econometrician, bless you, you can understand that there's something crazy about using 5%. So there's one way of expressing what I'm saying, but it's worse. It's actually worse. Now, I've been arguing this way for 25 years. You can think of me as clinging to the knees of the economics profession, saying, oh, please, per favore, come on, please stop doing this. You're wrecking my beloved economics. Because I became convinced in the early 1980s that, or you know, it took me a while because I had three courses in econometrics. For a person of my PhD generation, which is before the beginning of time, I'm very well trained in econometrics. I was trained by some of the best econometricians in the world. Then I was, as you mentioned, I was at the University of Chicago, which had three of the best econometricians in the world, Mark Nerlov, Willekes, Hans Teil, and Arnold Zeller. All four I ate lunch with, talked to them constantly. Unfortunately, they hated each other. Each one hated the other three, so it didn't amount to anything. But still, they so I pretty sophisticated by the standards of the 1960s in econometrics. Yet, I gradually realized that tests of statistical significance are not just to be used carefully, but are not to be used at all. Let me state it in a clear way. Statistical significance, as opposed to substantive, economic, policy, medical, legal, sociological significance, where you do have a loss function, where you are thinking about how much does it matter whether I overestimate this or underestimate it, right? Statistical significance, 0.05, 0.01, that, as I told you, is not really the full point, is neither necessary nor sufficient for substantive scientific significance. Now, it's kind of obvious that it's not sufficient. You know, you could have a lot of crazy correlations, R-squares that are very high, that you know are wrong, or are not illuminating, are not something you want to use for policy. In an old popular book around 1960, in statistics, which I wrote a long time ago, I read, he has this scatter of points of that this was a British book, so it was number of amateur radio operator licenses given in the United Kingdom each year from 1950 to 1960. And then on the other axis, the number of people each year certified insane, crazy, and word, wonderful correlation. So let's see, we're going to use this for policy. Let's deny people amateur radio operator licenses in order to reduce the number of people insane.
Or the other way around.
Or the other way around. Let's stop declaring people insane. Let them be insane. And that, you know, I mean, it's just, it's up, you know. So that's clear. That's the sufficiency point. And I think everyone here will agree that, well, of course, I was just explaining this to a journalist, and of course, you know, everyone knows, your mother knows, your aunt knows that correlation does not imply causation, right? We all know that. And that's what the identification problem is. That's what we're trying to do with specification error. When we think we've got specification error, we say, oops, wait a second, these are or multicollinearity. So there's a lot of thinking about the insufficiency of statistical significance. But people want to argue because they want to hold on to this thing. They love it because it's easy. In the age of falling costs of computation, at least in the middle age of falling costs of computation, it comes out of the programs. Statistical significance is very easy to calculate once you have the covariance matrix, and you can adjust it and do all you want. But anyway, there it is. Very easy. So it comes out automatically, and you say, well, I want to use this since it's such an easy tool. But it's like using a hammer as a saw. It's not necessary. Here's one thing I often hear. People say, well, yeah, I see what you mean. Some people have flattered me by saying, oh, yeah, economists, since you've started to write on this, and then Steve Zunziliak joined me in the 90s, and we've been writing on it ever since. Oh, yeah, you guys have persuaded people to talk about substantive economic significance. in their papers. Well, I doubt that I've had any effect at all, but okay, that's nice. I'm glad to have had that effect. But they do the statistical significance too. And so what they say is, aha, first we'll put our data, COPTA, through a screen of statistical significance. And we'll find whether or not the effect exists. Then having determined that, we then will judge whether the effect is large or not, economically important. Well, it sounds reasonable, but it's, there was distributed a copy of a paper that, a note that that Steve and I just wrote in answer to, my old friend, Tom Meyer, who wrote in 1980 a paper making the same point that I made some years afterwards. This point, by the way, is made over and over again in the history of statistics. In fact, it was made by student T. Gossett, who was an employee of the Guinness Brewery. He made the point in the 1920s, same point I'm making. Kenneth Arrow made the point in 1957, if you need more authority than crazy old Deirdre McCloskey. Arnold Zellner made the point. Tom made the point, but Tom has gone back on his word. Now he thinks, well, maybe there's some use of statistical significance. And what I'm telling you is that it's also not necessary. In fact, you know, I could be radical about it and make you angry by calling it names. Stupido non stupido, right? It is foolish. It's deeply foolish to use this test because it mixes up two things. And it says fit is the same thing as importance. I have a highly sophisticated word that I use for this. This is Greek. All technical vocabulary comes from Greek. Oof. It's not Greek. How much effect one variable has on another? How much does an increase in the money supply increase the price level? In my opinion, in an open economy, zero, but you know, there's controversy about that. Oomph is what we seek in science. And fit is another matter. It's clearly a separate matter. Let's agree on that. Even if you're a big enthusiast for tests of statistical significance, you'll agree that at least, you know, we have, I don't know, prices in the EU and prices in the rest of the world, exchange rate corrected, okay, price of the euro, exchange rate corrected, we have observations like this. The oomph is, among other things, the slope. And whether or not the fit is good is another question, right? But observe, the way we do it, and I kept being told, oh no, everyone knows that. You know the three stages of a scientific proposition? This is the first stage is, oh, that's stupid, you're wrong, you're a bad person to say that, whatever it is, MV equals PT or something, you're a bad person. The second stage is, oh, everyone knows that, what are you talking about, that's obvious. Why are you boring us with this talk? Third stage is, that is true. It is deeply important, and I invented it. And this point about that among sort of sophisticated people in econometrics, they often say to me, oh yeah, everyone knows that. I had a shocking conversation with Jim Heckman, who was a colleague of mine once, and has won the Nobel Prize, as he should. He's a marvelous economist, not such a nice guy, but a wonderful economist. And he teaches the compulsory first year econometrics course at the University of Chicago. And about 6-7 years ago, I was at a small conference with Heckman. And he said, Jim, you know, I've noticed that you don't ever use statistical tests of statistical significance in your own work. And he said, well, of course I don't. Only idiots use tests of statistical significance. I said, Jim, I know from your students that in the compulsory econometrics course, you teach them to use tests of statistical significance. Why is that? Oh, he said, they're too stupid to do anything else. Which is unethical, immoral on a number of levels. Orly Ashenfelter, very good economist, much nicer person than Heckman. Longtime editor of the American Economic Review, an econometric labor economist who, like Jim, teaches the compulsory econometrics course at Princeton. He sent me a postcard once. Said, I've been carrying around your little pamphlet, which I highly recommend to you. It's called The Secret Sins of Economics. If you Google my name and The Secret Sins, you'll get a link to a free copy. It's 90 pages long. It's aimed at anthropologists. Sort of tell anthropologists, is it wrong that economists use numbers? No, come on guys, it's okay. Is it wrong that a lot of economists are free market types? No, that's not what's wrong. And there are two secret sins. One of them, statistical significance. And Orly sent me this postcard, which said, I've been carrying your pamphlet around for a few months. I finally read it. It's a small thing. And I tend to agree. Well, Orly Ashenfelter has come on the side of the angels. Bravo. But, said he, young people need to have a career. Well, so fit is not the same thing. And fit is usually not the scientific issue at stake. Furthermore, just in case you're inclined to say, well, at least it tells us how certain we are of the estimate. But you know, being certain of the estimate is not the same thing as answering the question, how big is it? How important is it? They're not the same. That's what I've been saying. But in case you're inclined to say, well, at least it tells us how uncertain we are about the estimate, how fuzzily it's estimated, so on, I say to you, no, it usually does not. Because in order for it to do that, the problem, the main scientific problem, has to be small samples. If you have a large sample, or as is very commonly the case in economics, you have the entire universe, the urn of nature, think back to your early probability course, the urn of nature, the black balls and the red balls, the famous black balls and red balls, are spilled out on the floor before you. You don't have a sampling problem, you have a counting problem. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4. So, and furthermore, mostly what our problem is, to go back to this thing that I wholly approve of, I think it's great, the fitting hyperplanes. Some of my best friends are hyperplanes. I like hyperplanes. Mostly our problem is specification error. Don't you agree? Mostly to speak in kind of antique terms, the model is under-identified, say. And we think we're fitting a demand curve when actually it's a bunch of equilibria of supply and demand. That's one case. Or it's biased samples. That's what Jim Hickman got the Nobel Prize for, is noticing that, as you know, a lot of the Nobel Prizes sound kind of obvious when you put them in ordinary terms, that being in and outside of economic samples is often a result of economic behavior. So those people who are employed are not a random sample of the potential labor force. I mean, you could, right? That was Jim's point, and it's a very, very important point, but it's not solved by having a larger sample. If you got a biased sample, all you do is you get more, if you get a larger sample and you follow statistical significance, you get more and more confident of an incorrect result. So you boldly go and say, "Well, you fools, don't you know? The minimum wage has the following effect. Stop." Don't. Well, let me conclude, then we can have some conversation. But let me give you two pieces of empirical evidence. You misused the word empirical, by the way, in introducing me. Empirical doesn't mean the same thing as econometric. It doesn't mean the same thing as using tests of statistical significance. Yet, because we insist in graduate programs on 3 courses in econometrics, that's what the students learn. Empirical means, from Greek, experience. You know, let's go to the world and see what the world says. And it is not the case that the only way to find out what the world says or suggests is to do a regression. It's not true. You can simulate, for example, which as the cost of computation falls is going to become more and more important in economics. You can use natural historical experiments. Most people were convinced that at least at the world level, MV equals PT by the experience of the 1970s and 1980s, when the world price level increased faster than it ever had in the history of humans. It increased by a factor of 4 in 15 years. That's as much as the whole so-called price revolution of the 16th and early 17th century caused. But that took 120 years. This took 15 years. And, you know, it was pretty obvious that what was happening is that central bankers were printing money. You know, you could say, oh, it's the oil prices. Come on, it's not the oil prices. It's that they were printing money. MV equals PT. So there's a historical experiment. Because we're the molecules that we're trying to explain, you can use introspection if you do it intelligently, the way people in the English department do. If you ask yourself, what kind of reader of the world are you? Okay. You can use experiments. I've become kind of a convert to experiments. Not the double-blind controlled experiments from those people at MIT. Those are regarded as largely unethical because they're experimenting on poor Africans. And I find that revolting. And they're experimenting to find out the truth of things we already know. Like, here's one they actually do. Like, do mosquito nets reduce malaria? Well, yeah, we've known that for some time. You know that in Venice. Malaria. We don't know. Most people don't know it's an Italian word. Malaria. Put screens in, poof, away goes the bad air. Right? But I'm in favor of classroom experiments or experiments with games and so on. Some of the techniques that we use in the history department are things that ought to be taught to graduate students in economics. They ought to know how to go to archives. They ought to know that the social statistics, the data, the things given that they're talking about are often coming from official government reports. So we ought to know about how official government reports are collected. We ought to know. We ought to know accounting. We ought to know national income accounting. How much is national income accounting taught anymore? Not much. We ought to know about error analysis. We ought to know about what's it called? Rounding error in computer programs. We ought to know about surveys. The unemployment rate is determined by asking people. It's a survey, right? Economists know nothing about surveys. They say, oh, you can't talk to business people. That's forbidden. Don't talk to them. Don't ask them anything. How do you think Ronald Coase got his Nobel Prize? By listening to business people. You didn't talk to them too much. You just sat there and watched them. And notice, my God, they're spending a lot of time negotiating this contract. Transactions costs. So none of these, or graphing. One of the great books of the 20th century is called The Visual Display of Quantitative Information by a man, by a political scientist at Yale called Tufte, T-U-F-T-E. And he's done a couple of other books. The Visual Display of Quantitative Information. And if you haven't seen that book, go see it this afternoon. Go order it. It'll change your life. Because graphing, again, as computer costs get lower and lower, is what we should be doing. Showing things, showing the world in graphs, three-dimensional, blah, blah. I belong to a club in Chicago that has a lot of architects in it. Architects don't draw anymore. Young architects don't draw. They simulate the building on a computer. Then they walk inside it and they notice, whoops, there's a big hole here. Oh yeah, we mismeasured the walls. They go back and change the measurement of the walls. So I propose that we stop over-teaching tests of statistical significance and start teaching real quantitative methods in graduate programs. So, you know, I don't think I'll this afternoon persuade anyone. I've been through this a lot. People get mad at me. They think she's, how can she know? She's just an economic historian, economic philosopher. What does she know? She's crazy anyway. She's offended me because I love R.A. Fisher. there are all kinds of reasons. My teachers told me this. What do you mean? Don't you like my teachers? You're a bitch. Now that I've changed gender, that one comes in. Before, they didn't care. He's a tough guy. Oh, McCloskey, he's very tough. Now when I'm with Deirdre, act like my mother was very tough. He said, that bitch. So I don't expect I'll change your minds. But what I do ask you to do for your own scientific health is consider that you might be mistaken. Just consider it. Seriously consider it. Don't think, oh, well, they do it in all the journals. I've got to do it because the journals do it. If you want to be such a coward, go ahead and be a coward. But just do it to make the referees feel nice. But don't ever let your scientific life be determined by it. Make sure you look at oomph, talk about oomph, decide whether to include or not to include variables because of oomph, not because of statistical significance. Please, please do it. Beg for that.